Welcome to the second session of today, and this session is going to last for approximately an hour. And here we have three debates on controversial issues, and this session is going to be moderated by Dr. Ujjal Poddar. I'm sure that you all know Dr. Ujjal Poddar very well, and he is the professor and is a lead person for the pediatric gastroenterology department at Sanjay Gandhi Postgraduate Institute at Lucknow. And I welcome Dr. Poddar to take over the session and introduce the speakers for the first debate. Over to you, Dr. Poddar, please.
Thank you, Vishwanath. At the onset, I must thank Ispagan to introduce such a nice session. This is first time in the history of our society we are having a debate session that also back to back three topics. So good morning, everybody. I welcome you all to this interesting session. As Vishwanath said, that there are three topics, the common topics, the day-to-day practice topic, and we are going to have debate on that. These are all unrelated, not related topics. So at the end of each topic, I will try to sum up and try to give you a message. So let us start the debate. And incidentally, in this debate session, out of six speakers, we have six renowned speakers. Four of them are happen to be my student. So it is a proud moment for me to introduce four of my students as speaker out of six. But simultaneously, I want to say that as a moderator, I am not going to be biased, do any partiality to my student. Whoever can logically establish his point is going to win that debate, right? So without wasting much time, I'll introduce the first topic and very interesting topic, hepatitis B with normal enzymes. Got a child who's SGOTPT bank normal, he doesn't have any disease, but he has hepatitis B. Should we treat or not to treat? For this session, we have Dr. Bibor Borkar. He is from Mumbai, and he's happened to be the first DM pediatric gastroenterology of India, along with Rohan. And he will speak in favor, means he wants to treat all these kids who has normal enzyme. And Dr. Rajiv Khanna, who is additional professor at ILBS, is going to speak against. So he doesn't want to treat those cases. So let us start the debate.
So to start the debate, I'll be talking in favor of treating the children with a normal enzyme. Let's go ahead with how a chronic hepatitis B behaves in individuals. So the phases of hepatitis B infection has been classified into four phases. Broadly, either one can have a hepatitis E antigen positive state or hepatitis E antigen negative state. In HBE antigen positive state, the initial one is a phase where we call it as a hepatitis E chronic infection state, where we get very high DNA, HBV DNA, hepatitis E Ag is positive, HBs Ag is high. So the virus is in very high replicative phase. However, there is not much liver damage, which has been like seen as a normal ANT and none or mild fibrosis of the liver disease. So initially, this phase was called as an immune tolerant phase. Later, then there is a chronic hepatitis because of HBA in a HBE E antigen positive patient, where hepatitis E is positive, HBV DNA is still high but lower than the immune tolerant phase. HBs Ag is also high. However, there is now some liver injury which is manifest as high ALT, increased ALT and AST, and there is a liver disease which is a moderate to severe degree of liver damage. Now, initially it was called as an immune reactive phase. Later on, so the patients can go in a chronic carrier state and go in hepatitis HBe Ag negative chronic infection where there is HBsAg is low, HBeAg is negative, HBvDNA is low, and liver damage wise, SGOT and SGPTs are normal, and liver disease, there's hardly much damage. We call it as an inactive carrier state. And later on, there can be a reactivation of hepatitis B intermittent, so called as an HBeAg negative chronic hepatitis, where HBeAg is negative. However, HBvDNA is more than 2000 IU per ml. ALT starts elevating, and again, there is a liver disease, which is a moderate to severe degrees of inflammation and the fibrosis. What is as an HBeAg negative chronic hepatitis? Now, various guidelines suggest that chronic hepatitis, HBeAg positive chronic hepatitis E should be treated. HBeAg negative chronic hepatitis should not be treated. Sorry, should be treated. Inactive carrier state, there is no need. However, the chronic infection initially called as a immune tolerant phase, most of the guidelines suggest that there is no treatment required. Multiple guidelines like Istanbul guidelines, EASL, ASLD, APASL guidelines. So this is our topic of debate today. So when you're treating hepatitis B infection, the goals of treatment is to improve survival and quality of life by preventing disease progression and prevent hepatocellular carcinoma in the liver. Apart from that, other goals are to prevent mother-to-child transmission, hepatitis B reactivation, and prevention of treatment to HBV-associated extrahepatic manifestations. Of course, the other goals, whenever these indications are there, they become basically, again, indication for a treatment in immunotolerant phase. So all these guidelines, when they mention that children in immunotolerant phase, the treatment is not required, is based on certain assumptions. So these are like during this phase, liver is healthy and there is no inflammation at all. There is absence of liver fibrosis and the available treatment may not be effective. And this phase generally, it doesn't contribute to the development of hepatocellular carcinoma. So if you see, okay, if these arguments are valid, then it doesn't affect our goal of the treatment, which is improval of the survival, quality of preventing the disease progression and prevention of SCC development. But let's see, are these arguments black and white, or are there shades of gray in this? So most of the studies in the children where they have done biopsies in immune tolerant phase, there is a minimal or mild inflammation. However, few studies where it has been shown, so one is from India and another is from Hong Kong. So here there has been a young adolescent and the young adults where they are saying that even in a patient who has a normal liver function test, it will be done higher DNA. So there was a fibrosis in a significant percentage of individual. So this basically puts a query whether immune tolerant phase is it entirely benign one. So normal ALT does tell about a probably lack of inflammation, but the process of fibrosis is a accumulated result of an accumulated insult or repeated inflammation. So sometimes that liver fibrosis can be still there. Of course, these are of a little bit older individuals, not in the children, but probably we don't know where exactly this conversion happens. Then, so what happens to the patient who have a HCC? So once in an immune tolerant phase, so the cytotoxic T cells gradually kill the hepatocytes which are infected, and gradually because of during the persistent viremia, there is a selective.
More, you have 1 minute more.
Okay, so sometimes there is a selection of an infected hepatocytes, and these are the infected hepatocytes killed by the antiviral cytotoxic T cells, and there is a clonal expansion of altered hepatocytes. So then these altered hepatocytes, there is a clonal proliferation, and then the selection of these hepatocytes. So there is an evaluation of HCC in this phase is being seen, and this area, this this has been seen in common in both immunotolerant phase and immune active phase also. So there has been few studies where there has been children has been treated with sequential therapies with LAM in interferon or in entecavir and PEG interferon, and they have, though the results are mixed, where there has been HBV clearance, the results are not consistent. But yes, few studies has shown a promising result. So in conclusion, that IT phase may have a fibrosis in adolescent and young age group. So we don't know where exactly this process starts. HCC development can begin in immunotolerant phase, so it's not a benign phase. And the newer antivirals have a minimal drug resistance and effectively suppress HBV DNA and can decrease the development of cirrhosis and HCC in high risk children. But what should be a correct treatment modality? Probably this is still a debatable. Okay, I will hand over debate to Dr. Raju for his comments. Thank you.
Good morning. First of all, I would like to thank organizers for giving me this opportunity, and thanks Dr. Vishwanathan and Dr. Poddar for selecting me for this topic. And I am going to speak against treating children with hepatitis B with normal liver enzymes. So I will give my talk under these headings. So what are the evidences from the guidelines, from the natural history, basic science, and also from the clinical studies? So from the guidelines, as Dr. Vibhor has already pointed, so that none of the guidelines say that we can treat immunotolerant children. So that is those with normal liver enzymes, whether we see ASLD, FSL, or SPGAN, only the children who have high ALT more than 2 times upper limit of normal, or those who are cirrhotics with active inflammation or advanced fibrosis or reactivation, or with family history of HCC, they need to be treated. And also HBV antigen negative hepatitis patients with significant inflammation or with raised liver enzymes. So coming on to the natural history, some of these things have already been discussed by Vibhor. So as we can see here, there are two phases in the natural history of hepatitis B infection when the liver enzymes will be normal. So this is immunotolerant phase and inactive carrier stage. So I'm not going to discuss the inactive carrier stage because this stage obviously does not need any treatment because the viral load is low and the liver enzymes are absolutely normal. So from now onwards, I will be discussing only the immunotolerant phase of infection. So if we see the natural history of infection from Taiwan, 415 children, which were followed up for a longer period of time. And so they have shown that 38% of the children got seroconverted and half of the children got seroconverted within 2 years of time. And a very small number had re-elevation of liver enzymes, and majority of the children who were biopsied, so they had just mild or minimal inflammation. Again, if we see a long-term study on HBs antigen clearance, so it was shown that 12% of the patients, when they were followed up, so they can clear the virus at a mean age of around 17 years with a mean annual HBs antigen clearance rate of around 0.58%. And this rate depends on the maternal HBs antigen negativity, E antigen negativity, and the child HBe antigen seroconversion, and the titers of HBs antigen, quantitative HBs antigen. So now coming to the basic science. So there is evidence from the basic science as per this study from literature where immunotolerant children were compared with chronic active hepatitis B adults and with inactive carriers. So it was shown that these immunotolerant children had lower CCL3 levels, and also they had exhausted profile of T cells when the flow cytometry was seen. So their PD-1 levels were different in comparison to the adults with chronic active hepatitis who were older. So next, coming to the clinical studies, so what does the data say? So there are, as Vibhor has already pointed, that what should be the goals of treatment? The goals of treatment should be to suppress viral replication, the DNA should become negative, seroconversion, and last endpoint is, which is very difficult to achieve, is HBs antigen seroconversion. So there are three studies which favor treatment. So I will critically analyze these studies. So first one is from King's, another one is from SGPGI, and another is from China, where the HBE antigen seroconversion rates have been shown between 22 to 39%, and HBS antigen loss between 17 to 22%. So sequential treatment was given as antiviral followed by combination of antiviral and interferon. So this was the randomized control trial from China, recently published. So on careful dissection, we found that ALT levels which were used in these studies were up to 1.5 to 2 times of upper limit of normal, so which may cause mislabeling of the immunoclearance or immunotolerant phase. So again, if we see, so what is normal ALT? So normal ALT levels, as per this data from US, in 4,000 children, it has been shown that the 97th centile of the liver enzyme may range from 24 to 32 in girls and 29 to 38 in boys. So age-dependent upper limit should be chosen to label as normal or abnormal ALT. Again, from the randomized control trial from China, it has been shown that the ALT levels predicted the response. So some of the patients may be in the immunoclearance phase, as I already said. And in the Chinese study, there were older children, and also from the SGPGA study, around 1/3 of the children had some fibrosis. So they may be in the immunoclearance phase of infection. Again, from the SGPGA study, one of the child had reversal of the seroconversion, again doubting the efficacy of the therapy. Lastly, the seroconversion rates were not drastically better than expected from the natural history. So interferon when used in this study, so thus theoretically just it accelerates the course of infection in children who have greater disease activity and lower levels of replication. Coming on to study from our institute, from ILBS, when we compared sequential and standard treatment, and we found that in the immunotolerant children, we did not find any child who got HBe antigen seroconversion. We also found that the ALT levels predicted the response, and a cutoff of 100 IU per liter was predicted. The likelihood of response was around 9.5. So higher ALT, that is means immunoclearance phase only, then only there will be better response to treatment. So this is another multi-center trial from US where it has been shown. This is again a negative trial. We are
Raju, one more minute for you.
Lamivudine along with pegylated. So where anticovir was used along with pegylated interferon, and it was shown that the response rate was in just 2 children, and 2 more became HB antigen negative. So overall 6.7%, which was significantly lesser in contrast to the other studies which were shown. Interferon, as we all know, they are full of side effects, fever, anorexia, behavioral changes, nausea and vomiting, diarrhea and GI upset, and many more. And dose reduction is required in around 1/4 of the children. So we have seen that there is poor efficacy of treatment when we use it in immunotolerant children. There are side effects, and duration of treatment is not clearly defined, and there is a risk of resistance. So the treatment is not very cost effective. So finally, I can say that hepatitis B in children with normal liver enzymes, we have to differentiate between immunotolerant versus inactive carriers. And the immunotolerant phase do not require any treatment because the results are not better than natural history. And the basic science data also does not support. So guidelines do not recommend. There is no definite endpoint. And also theoretically, there is a risk of antiviral resistance in the long term.
So the title of the debate was with the normal enzyme. Rajiv has rightly said there are two sets of children who can have normal enzyme with chronic hepatitis B. Inactive carrier, obviously, we are not going to treat. Though the Chinese people have treated and shown good response, that is not the issue. Immune tolerant, whether to treat or not to treat. I am going to coin this phrase, window of opportunity. Let us see what is there. First, let me show you all the 5 studies which have been quoted by both Bivor and Rajiv. The first 3 studies use the similar combination, lamivudine with plain interferon. Duration was almost same with some difference in juice study, and very good response. The later 2, the study from USA and Canada, they have shown use the entecavir followed by PEG interferon, and the Rajiv's group have used the LAM or tenofovir with PEG interferon, and they showed not a good response. So what is the difference between these 2 sets? One set of 3 studies is showing HBCG clearance in the tune of 17 to 22%. Another set says that it is very poor. though that Rosenthal study HBSG clearance should be 7% because they have the data of 45 patients out of 60 who completed the study, and out of that at least 3 clear the HBSG. But anyway, that number is still 7% is less than 17%. And the Bikrant study from ILBS out of 12, the number is very small. Now in statistics, you are always worried about 0 and 100. If somebody said there's zero response, you start doubting. If somebody says 100% response, you start doubting. Now the same study, they have 17 patients of immunoactive hepatitis B, and they've shown the HBsAg e antigen seroconversion is 65%. There is no study in this world have shown such a high figure of HBsAg e antigen seroconversion. So that's because of the number. You know that alpha error, beta error, because of the type 1, type 2, small number. So set aside the study, but we cannot ignore that Rosenthal study that they showed there's no response. This is my comment about this debate, that we cannot ignore this part that normal ALT should not be treated because of the consequence of hepatitis B integration and subsequent development of HCC. Thanks.
Thank you.
Now we are moving on to a different set of debate. From liver, now we go to the lumen. Now we have a very interesting topic here. Inflammatory bowel disease, should we start with the step down rather than top up? We have a two renowned speaker, Rishi from All India Institute of Medical Science, Rishikesh, and Geeta. I think Geeta is going to speak in favor of starting top down, and Rishi is going to speak against the motion. So can I ask Geeta to start, please?
Good morning, everybody, and thank you, Dr. Ojal, and to the organizers for giving me this opportunity. In the interest of time, I'll be moving to the topic, and the topic I'll be speaking for top down in favor of inflammatory bowel disease. So let's start with what we do know about pediatric inflammatory disease. We know progressive disease, and compared to us, it's much more severe and has an aggressive phenotype. Children have unique complications like growth impairment and growth failure, and therefore treatment must be treat to target. And as we all know, the paradigms of treatment have changed in recent years, the goalposts have changed. Whereas clinical remission was the initial goals of treatment, nowadays the goal of the treat to target is mucosal healing or deep remission, which in turn can change the course of the disease. So the key factor here would be mucosal healing. And I'm here to say that top-down therapy is the way to go for better mucosal healing, which in turn alters the natural history of the disease. It decreases the need for hospitalization and surgery, restores early growth trajectory of the child, is cost-effective in today's world, and has only comparable side effects. So let's see the evidence for all this. As we all know, inflammatory bowel disease is a chronic prolonged inflammation, and the inflammation gets prolonged even before the diagnosis is made, and sometimes even after the diagnosis is made, because it takes longer to get them into remission. So the longer it takes to achieve remission, the greater the risk of complications. So like Dr. Ujjal was saying for the previous case, there is a window of opportunity in these patients, and the window of opportunity lies somewhere from the onset of disease to somewhere where the diagnosis is made. In Crohn's disease, we know that the time taken for diagnosis could be 1 year to 6 years or even 7 years before the diagnosis is made and treatment is started. Now, it's not justifiable that we continue to prolong the onset of remission even later than that, or else we would miss the window of opportunity, thereby putting these children or patients further into chronic inflammation, resulting in increase in complications, increased risk of surgery and possible stricture. So tighter control, earlier remission and tighter control of the disease would actually effectively improve the outcome for these patients and thereby improve the natural history of the disease. As we know now, the endoscopic healing is the driver for success, and this is the goal that we should aim to achieve both in ulcerative colitis as well as in Crohn's disease. So the likelihood of achieving mucosal healing in step-up and top-down treatment. Now the top-down treatment is in yellow and the step-up is in red. As you can see by this slide, by week 52, that is the 1 year, top-down would have achieved higher remissions as compared to step-up therapy. And at the end of 2 years, this probably would be equal. The number of patients reaching to the level of remission would be almost equal, but all these patients in step-up would ultimately require TNF antagonists at this point? And what have we lost in the meantime of these 2 years? We have lost a significant amount of time where these children could have actually grown in remission as compared to step-up therapy. These same results, which were initially seen in adult studies, have been implicated in pediatric studies in 2016 and 2015. So the disadvantages of step-up therapy is that patients have to earn their treatment, the more effective treatment. And this earning is determined by us doctors. This results in a decrease in the quality of life before the patient obtains optimal therapy, and therefore the likelihood of complication, surgery is high, and the disease course is not modified. What about the argument that this step-up therapy would be better, decrease in formation surgery, the stop-up would not? I would argue that top-up decreases the need for hospitalization and surgery, especially with the advent of better anti-TNF antagonists, wherein we don't need to hospitalize this patient for the treatment. In both Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, mucosal healing is the key to remission and the key to better outcomes, lesser hospitalization, lesser surgery. Therefore, if you do not achieve mucosal healing early, you cannot decrease the colectomy and resection rates. This slide also shows that the time to first hospitalization, the time to the first surgery or complication is actually, the incidence is higher when there is a step-up therapy or conventional management as compared to early combined immunosuppression. The incidence to all is much lower. And also the important factor in pediatric age group is the restoration of early growth trajectory of a child. This can occur only when there is early remission of the disease. As you all know, growth failure occurs in about 35% of all IBD, much more severe in Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, resulting in about 25% of patients not achieving their height potential. This study elegantly shows that early anti-TNF therapy is the only therapy that actually improves the height Z-score of patients, whereas all other therapies is a negative level. Therefore, if you want to effectively improve the height and the ultimate outcome in these children, you have to start hard, hit hard, and make sure that you get remission much earlier in the disease. So the growth failure and top-down versus step-up, the therapeutic target must be achieved early in the disease so that irreversible sequelae can be mitigated. And those treated with anti-TNF therapy, within the first 3 months, about 85% versus 60% have improvement in the growth. What about cost effectiveness? As you can understand, if you get early mucosal clearance, studies have shown that lesser hospitalization, lesser complication, lesser surgery would ultimately result in lesser cost for these patients, though the cost effectiveness may not be as evident in the initial phases. In the long term, definitely they are cost effective. With the advent of biosimilars, the cost effectiveness in the short term can also be seen. Safety profile, the risk of infection was thought to be there for anti-TNF medications, but the TREAT registry has negated these effects. And even with the latest medications, you can see that compared to placebo, there is only negligible increase in infection, and in some cases, it is almost even lesser. What about the risk of malignancy? There is no increased risk of malignancy in anti-TNF medication. Actually, the risk of malignancy was found to be due to thiopurines, which is there for all medications. Pediatric age group forms special groups where the therapy is definitely indicated in top-down. So in summary, I think it's time that the pediatric gastroenterology group embraces a treat-to-target approach. And the most consistent, effective, and shortest route for this would be a top-down therapy. It brings additional benefits with no additional complications, and it's even more affordable. So I would conclude that top-down therapy should be the first line of management in childhood inflammatory bowel disease. Thank you.
Now this is turn of Rishi. Now Rishi Valia is going to speak against the motion that we start with step up instead of top down. Rishi, please.
Okay, so coming straight away to the topic. So right now in front of you is the therapeutic pyramid of inflammatory bowel disease, and the issue that we are discussing today. The issue that we are discussing today is whether one should adopt a step-up approach, that is, start off with drugs that are relatively safe, cheaper, and have a reasonably good efficacy, and then move on to drugs which have a greater efficacy, but also come with a greater risk and are fairly expensive only when the disease is refractory, or one should have a top-down approach, that is, bring in these big guns right at the beginning. Now, the step-up approach is the traditional way of treating IBD. By top-down is something, it's a new kid on the block. Old is gold, and I'm sure over the next 5 minutes, I'll be able to convince all of you that step-up is the right choice. Let us start by looking at the natural history of pediatric IBD. For pediatric ulcerative colitis, the lifetime estimate of exposure to biological therapies is somewhere between 10 to 30%, where in Crohn's disease, it's only a third of patients who receive biologicals within the first 5 years of their diagnosis. So the point that I want to bring out here is that 65 to 90% children do not require biologicals during their disease course. So fundamentally, starting top down with biological first does not make sense. There's a fundamental flaw in the top-down approach, because you're unnecessarily exposing your patients to biological therapy, which they probably do not need. Now, let us look at some of these studies that have compared top-down and step-up studies. The first study from the North American Consortium, a retrospective study of 68 patients in each arm, they looked at remission at the end of 1 year, and they found that the early biological therapy had better remission rates. The second study, JPG in 2015 from South Korea, again a retrospective study, they looked at relapse-free rates at the end of 3 years, and they found that it was better in the top-down group. The same group then did a prospective study, and they found that mucosal healing was also better at 1 year. So does it mean that top-down is better than step-up? Not really, because we have to clearly look closer at these studies. First of all, these studies, they had small numbers, they were retrospective, and if you look at the endpoints that they looked at, such as relapse-free rates and remission, they are relatively softer endpoints. Now, let us look at studies that have looked at harder or more concrete endpoints, such as the progression to stricturing or penetrating disease or the need for surgery. So there are a couple of studies that I'd like to bring up. The first one, published in The Lancet 2017, again from the North American Consortium. Around 1,800 children were enrolled in this multi-center inception cohort, of which 191 had received early biological therapy. What was found that there was no difference in the progression to stricturing and penetrating disease in the group that received early or late biological therapy. Now, looking at the incidence of or the need for surgery, this study, again, a multiple inception cohort, a prospective study enrolling almost 1,291 children, of whom 145 had received early biologics, it was seen that the 10-year cumulative rate of surgery did not vary with the early or late initiation of biologic therapy. Now, let us look at the cost too, because biologics are not cheap. So this is a very recent publication, which looked at the cost effectiveness and clinical outcome of early anti-TNF therapy in pediatric Crohn's disease. What this group found was that early TNF therapy had an incremental cost of $31,000 as compared to setup therapy, which is almost 17 lakh rupees per patient for a period of 3 years. And what did they get? What was the benefit by spending so much? That the patients who had an early TNF therapy, who were in the early TNF therapy arm, had 11 more weeks of steroid-free remission. So is it worth it? I definitely do not think so. Now, the most important point is top-down is not really top-down. I think it is just starting at the top and staying on the top. For this, I'd like to bring up this study. And I believe this is the only true top-down study that has been published in children. Because if you look at the other studies, they have started with early biological therapy, but there's never been an attempt to step down. They've just started with biologicals and patients have stayed on biologicals for an infinite amount of time. In this study, 31 children were enrolled in the top-down arm. They were started on infliximab. At the end of 1 year, 26 went into clinical remission. And so infliximab was stopped and the children were continued on an immunomodulator. Within a few months, 12 of these 26 patients relapsed and infliximab had to be restarted. So if you have a close look, we'll see that 12 out of 31, a total of around 40% of these patients eventually ended up continuing on infliximab. Now, let us recall the natural history of Crohn's disease that I talked about earlier. We've seen that around a third of patients of Crohn's disease require biologicals eventually during that disease course. So I think this 38% that we see here is that group which would have required biologicals eventually, and probably starting biologicals in the remaining 62% didn't make any difference, and probably they didn't warrant it and they would have done well anyway. So there's a fundamental flaw with top-down therapy. So my final say would be top-down therapy is wrong because it causes an unnecessary exposure to toxic drugs to almost 60 to 70% children who don't actually need it. Then there's also the problem of what to do if these big guns, the biologicals, if they don't fire. Even in the study.
Yeah, 1 minute. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. So even in the study that I just mentioned earlier, 5 children did not respond to infliximab. Where to go from there? As I've shown, there are short-term gains, but biologics do not prevent the need for surgery. The cost difference is enormous, and in around 40% of patients, one really isn't able to go down from top to down. They just start at the top and remain at the top. Step-up therapy, on the other way, is the traditional way we treat patients, in which patient earns their treatment. And the big guns are just kept for the end, only if they're really needed. The only possible criticism of its top-up therapy is that, as Dr. Geeta said, that one may miss out on the window of opportunity, but there's a solution for that, and that is an accelerated step-up therapy. So don't wait. Start from the bottom, but if your patient isn't doing well, move up quickly up the ladder. So it's very important not to be myopic and looking at the big picture. Step-up therapy is the right choice.
Thank you.
But one point we agreed, both Rishi, Geeta, and probably me, that if cost is not a factor and you have the right case, you are not telling each and every patient. If you have a mild disease, obviously biological is out of question. If it is a fistulizing disease, more extensive disease, severe disease, failure of induction therapy, you would not mind starting biological as a top-down therapy. What Rishi has actually subtly said, accelerated top-down. Rishi, you agree?
I do agree, yes.
And in this debate, the topic we have kept is N-acetylcysteine in acute liver failure. N-acetylcysteine in acute liver failure, should we use it selectively or should be given the all patient? Now we have two speakers. Deepak Goyal will speak in favor and Vikrant Bihari Lal from ILBS, he will speak against. Means he wants that it should be given, it should be given selectively. Deepak is going to speak and Vikrant will speak that it should be given universally.
The topic is role of NAC N-acetylcysteine in acute liver failure. So I'll be talking in favor of selective use of N-acetyl in acute liver failure. So pediatric acute liver failure is a devastating disease in which previously healthy children rapidly lose hepatic function due to a variety of causes and become critically ill within days. Management of acute liver failure is largely supportive and only few conditions are amenable to directed therapy. Now, what does N-acetyl do? N-acetyl, the main action of N-acetyl, it acts as an antidote to acetaminophen toxicity by enhancing the mitochondrial and cytosolic glutathione stores, providing a glutathione substitute and enhancing the disposition by non-toxic sulfate conjugation. Then there are certain other actions of NAC. It acts as an antioxidant. Also, it has been implicated in free radical scavenging and subsequent cytoprotection. It has anti-inflammatory properties also via nuclear factor kappa B, and it has a mild vasodilatory effect also by improving microcirculatory flow. Now, I'll try to prove my point through the published literature. So in 2008, a study, retrospective study published by Kotsadaki et al., they had 59 patients under control group who did not receive N-acetylcysteine and 111 patients in the N-acetylcysteine group. The control group was enrolled from 1989 to 94, while the NAC group was between 1995 to 2004. All patients received the standard therapy and NAC was administered with the continuous infusion of 100 milligram per kilogram per day until normalization of INR, death or liver transplant. So the two groups were similar in terms of etiology of acute liver failure. So their study concluded that patients who received NAC had a great survival with their native liver as compared to the patients who did not receive NAC therapy, and an increased rate of survival after liver transplantation. And they concluded that patients receiving NAC had a significantly shorter hospital length of stay when compared to the patients not receiving NAC. So I am quoting this study as it has been cited by many further studies. In the consensus statement of pediatric gastroenterology chapter published in Indian Pediatrics in 2013, the committee stated that there is increased evidence for use of N-acetylcysteine in favor in non-acetaminophen causes of ALF also. So they recommended the routine use of NAC in all cases of ALF irrespective of etiology. But this statement was based on a retrospective single site review which I just quoted. So there were many limitations of this study. First, it was a single center study and the sample size was very small. And most importantly, the control group was historic. So the control group was taken enrolled between 1989 to 94 versus the NAC group, which was from 1995 to 2004. So in between, during these two times, the management also changes, and there can be a lot of variations in the management. So the taking a historic control group was not a good idea. And the control group also had advanced disease. So that could have altered their findings. Subsequently, the pediatric acute liver failure study group, they published their study in 2013 in hepatology. In this study, a total of 184 participants were enrolled in the trial with 92 in each arm. And their results were that 1 year survival did not differ significantly between the NAC group and the placebo treatment group. The 1 year transplant-free survival was significantly lower in those received NAC than those who received placebo, and particularly among less than 2 years. So they concluded that NAC did not improve 1 year survival in non-acetaminophen acute liver failure. And 1 year transplant-free survival was significantly lower with N-acetylcysteine, particularly among those less than 2 years old. And these results do not support the broad use of NAC in non-acetaminophen PAL and emphasize the importance of conducting other trials. So again, this paper is cited after in most of the studies till now. The explanation for not using NAC in all the acute liver failure is that a well-regulated inflammatory response is necessary for proper healing and regeneration. And should pro-inflammatory signals that initiate healing and regenerative response, if they are blunted at a critical time, they can cause an imbalance. So N-acetylcysteine, which serves in an antioxidant as well as anti-inflammatory properties, it can alter the secretion of a variety of chemokines and it could interrupt the healing inflammatory response. And prolonged treatment with NAC might suppress the hepatic regenerative response to injury, as shown in many animal studies also. Subsequently, meta-analysis published in Clinical Hepatology and Gastroenterology in 2015. They selected 4 clinical trials for meta-analysis, and total of 331 patients were enrolled receiving treatment with NAC versus 285 patients in the control group. And they have also concluded that NAC is safe for non-acetaminophen ALF. It is safe, but it can prolong patient survival with native liver without transplantation and survival after transplantation, but it cannot improve the overall survival.
Deepak, you've got 40 seconds. Thank you.
I'm just done. Subsequently, EASL clinical practice guidelines on management of ALF also have taken these citations, and they have also stated that it has not shown to be beneficial, and they have also not suggested the blanket use of N-acetylcysteine in all the acute liver failure group. In addition, they have advised to limit the clinical use of NAC to a maximum of 5 days duration, given its anti-inflammatory effect. In literature, indiscriminate use of N-acetylcysteine in all cases of pediatric acute liver failure is not justified. Thank you.
I'll be speaking on universal use of N-acetylcysteine in acute liver failure. So when I was given this topic, I was a bit skeptical because I believed the evidence was more in favor of selective use. But when I started going through the literature, I myself realized that NAC is actually useful and could be actually used universally in all kinds of acute liver failure. And I try to convince the audience in the next 6 minutes or so. There has been no questions on use of N-acetylcysteine on acetaminophen ALF, but can NAC be the wonder drug in ALF? Now, Deepak has already shown that there are multiple mechanisms of action for NAC, and if NAC acts on so many points in acute liver failure, can we use NAC in all patients with non-acetaminophen ALF? Now, the biggest evidence for use of NAC came from this landmark 2009 gastroenterology paper in the adult ALF study group, where they gave 150 mg per kg per day for 3 days. And they showed that native liver survival was better in NAC group as compared to placebo. And after this paper, the adult hepatologists universally started using NAC in ALF. But what is more important to take from this paper is that ALF with grade 1 to 2 hepatic encephalopathy receiving NAC did much better than placebo. Whereas if you see ALF with grade 3 to 4 encephalopathy receiving NAC actually did worse than placebo. What does that mean? That means you have to start NAC early and you have to give it for a shorter duration. So you have to hit early and hit hard. That should be the mantra here. But then came this paper in 2013, hepatology paper in 2013 from the PALF study group. Now, if you take this paper at face value, they will tell you that if you give NAC 150 mg per kg per day for 7 days, NAC is associated with poor native liver survival as compared to placebo, and it's bad. And after this, several centers in US stopped giving NAC in ALF. But let me tell you, actually, if you dig out this study, whenever you're in doubt about the results, it's best to go to the methodology and evaluate what was actually done. Now, let me show you. The time from admission to the time to enrollment was a median of 3 and an IQR of 7. That means more than 50% of patients in this PALF study group were started on NAC after 3 days, and more than 25% were started after day 7. So you have missed out on the golden therapeutic period where NAC would have been actually effective. Moreover, if you see, this study protocol gives NAC for 7 days. That means around more than 25% patients have started NAC on day 7 or later and have continued it till day 14 or later. Now, will giving such a prolonged NAC help or it will harm? We all know that it will harm because it has been well shown in animal studies that prolonged treatment with N-acetylcysteine, even in acetaminophen-induced liver injury, leads to poor liver regeneration and poor outcome. And this is because NAC inhibits NF-kappa beta and cyclin D1, which are very important mediators for liver regeneration in liver regeneration. So the crux of the matter is you have to give NAC at the right time. Now, in a natural history of PALF, there's a cytokine storm, and then there is functional immunoparesis, or there is liver regeneration. The patient survives or the patient dies. Now, the patient can come to you in the hospital at this point. When, if you give NAC here, when there is cytokine storm, it will be useful. It will be helpful. But if you give NAC here, when the patient is in functional immune paresis, then you may actually cause sepsis, which has been shown in one study. And if you give NAC at this time point when the liver was regenerating, then you are likely to stop regeneration and cause poor outcome. And that is possibly the reason why this study has shown this kind of result. The second biggest drawback of this study, this is not a homogeneous ALF group. The NAC group had significantly higher number of MLDs, that is Wilson disease, tyrosinemia, galactosemia, and 35% of known etiologies in ALF were actually cirrhotics. So do you expect giving NAC in cirrhotics will improve the outcome? No, absolutely not. In fact, I believe the potential for reversibility is the best, is the main feature of ALF. That is, the hepatic reserve is good. So if you give NAC in ALF, you are likely to have recovery. But if you give NAC in cirrhotics, there is no recovery. So including cirrhotics in this study, especially which were more in NAC group than in placebo group, could have altered the result drastically. And that brings us to the point that the PALS consensus definition should be changed at least for this kind of study, because it says no known evidence of chronic liver injury. Now this known word has to go. It has to be no evidence of chronic liver injury. Otherwise such heterogeneous group will give false results and people will interpret it differently, and such important therapeutics will get missed from the literature. So I believe this was a brilliant opportunity lost by the PALS study group. Now there are other studies. Again, this is not a randomized controlled trial, so I'll not give much importance to this. And this meta-analysis already shown by Deepak that—
You have 1 minute, thank you.
Yeah, so this meta-analysis has already shown that transplant-free survival was better with NAC despite including this negative study in this meta-analysis. And Deepak showed the ESL practice guidelines. I don't know how he missed, but ESL practice guidelines actually say that standard care of ALF is N-acetylcysteine in early stage, even in non-paracetamol cases, and restrict usage to a maximum of 5 days. So I'd like to conclude by saying that there are various plausible mechanisms for use of N-acetylcysteine in ALF. There are very limited trials. I don't know how you can stop at 2 trials and decide whether NAC is effective or not. There are equivocal results, but meta-analysis was in favor of using NAC. Universal use is advised, but start it early. Timing is important. Timing is the crux. And pediatric trials with robust design is the need of the hour. And this is an opportunity for ISPEGAN to collaborate on multicentric studies. And let's see what the results come out if we do such a trial. Thank you.
Let me show what Vikrant and Deepak said in just 2 slides. So these are the studies quoted by both Vikrant and Deepak, and this meta-analysis, everybody said that actually there are 2 studies, which are RCT, registered either retrospective observational study, and there is a recent adult study from Jammu and Kashmir. It is a, they said, claim it RCT, but may not be given 72 hours. What is the difference between pediatric and adult studies? That all the adult studies so far, 3 studies, they have restricted NAC therapy in 72 hours, what Vikrant has highlighted. But pediatric study has exceeded it, 7 days or till the recovery, and the result we know. So what will be the take home message? What Vikrant said, I partially agree with him, that we need more studies. One more point probably the Vikrant has not highlighted, the etiology of the liver disease. Beside this, your metabolic condition, there's a whole lot of indeterminate. On the contrary, what we face in our day-to-day practice, in our acute liver failure, predominantly it's the viral hepatitis related. In their study group, it is just less than 10%. So we don't know the whether this result can be replicated on our setup or not. We need a study. And especially in non-liver transplant center, where you don't have option of liver transplantation, you are banking heavily on the drugs, there is no harm. My take will be no harm in trying NAC. Yes, early, and limit the use by 3 to 5 days. Don't exceed 5 days, as it has been shown that N-acetylcysteine interferes with liver generation. So prolonged therapy may be detrimental. Thanks.
Thank you.